All right, good morning, everyone here in Sweden, and I guess good afternoon or good evening for anybody watching the live stream of Cloudburst 2. My name is Mark Brown. I'm a senior product marketing manager. I work in the Windows Azure team at Microsoft back in Redmond. Primarily focused on community programs, so I manage our group of MVPs, a lot of whom here are going to be giving talks today, and then another group of Azure Insiders, which is an even broader group of community people that are out there and helping people learn Azure, answer questions on forums, or writing blog posts, or giving talks at events like this. I want to just ask a couple of questions, I guess. How many were at Cloudburst last year, this group? Wow, good number of you. Okay, so how many of you have used Azure before? Okay, so I'm going to give an overview of Windows Azure. So maybe some of this is stuff that you've seen or heard, but if it's stuff that you forgot, then hopefully it'll be refreshing for you as well. There's a couple of themes I want to talk about with Windows Azure in my talk today, and really three main tenets for kind of the guiding principles behind Windows Azure. As you're all aware, Windows Azure is Microsoft's public cloud platform. And the three things we really care about when building and designing Windows Azure is, one, being flexible. We want to build Windows Azure so that you can use it to build anything and build amazing things with it. Infrastructure services gives you the ability to create virtual machines that can run nearly any workload. Virtual machines built on Windows or built on Linux, and connecting those to your network. Things like cloud services to build PaaS applications, cloud applications, decoupled applications to help you grow and scale, and even higher level PaaS like websites. So the flexibility we're talking about is the ability to provide the right level of compute services or storage services or data services to build the types of applications you want to build. Windows Azure is open. As I mentioned before, we provide Windows and Linux for virtual machines within there, but we also support a number of different frameworks and languages. We, of course, have great support for .NET within the Windows Azure public cloud, but we also have great support for PHP, Node.js, Python, and even Java and Ruby within there as well. And then lastly, Windows Azure is consistent. We know a lot of people are building applications today that are running in their own data center on premises. And we want to provide a consistency, and through things like the Windows Azure Pack, provide a consistent set of tools and management and scripts so that you can manage your environments both on premises and in the cloud. Right now, Windows Azure is growing rather fast. We've got about 10 regions, or we do have 10 regions, throughout the world right now, and we have about 10 more coming on within the next 18 months. And we've recently opened some new regions within mainland China. And we think this global coverage is going to make it easier for you to build applications to help you reach that global market. We're available within 89 countries and territories worldwide. I see Sweden right there, so you guys are all set. And that's currency support within there as well. And Windows Azure is a cloud platform, right? With elasticity, we want to make sure you can pay only what you use, right? Enable you to avoid having to pay upfront cost. And then, of course, scale as your business scales and grows. So let's get out of some slides and go straight into some demos here. So here we have the new Windows Azure portal right here. And you can see here's a bunch of services I've got running in here, some storage accounts within here. I have a number of virtual machines and some cloud services, some websites, virtual networks, and SQL databases. So what I'll do is I'll go in, I'll create a new virtual machine in here. Now I can do a quick create within here and just give it a name, or I can do from the gallery here as well. Let's go back and we'll do a quick create. Oops. So I'll just give this thing a name. And we'll select a medium size, and I'll go ahead and create a new admin name and password. Then I can select an affinity group. Now that'll go ahead and start provisioning right now. I've got another one right here that I've gone and created. And if I want, I can go ahead and just connect right into this thing. I knew I shouldn't have used Microsoft's corporate network. Magnus, is this feeling like what Brady went through last year?
Pretty much.
Okay, just checking. There we go. Except for the bug. There's no bug. My screen's just slow network. So as you can see right here, although it took a few minutes to get started, just a regular plain image of Windows Server right here. And I can go ahead and configure this thing to run as a file server, as a web server, basically to run any workload I want on here. And as soon as the screen comes up, I can actually do something with it and set it. Here we go. There we go. Okay, that's just what I wanted to show you. So if I go in here, I'm going to dashboard, and I can look through and I can get statistics on what's going on in here. I can configure endpoints, so I've got PowerShell, remote desktop. By the way, make sure you change your public port for the remote desktop. We all know this one, right? Yes? Okay. People scan for that. So if I want to go, I can create. Whoops, give it a name. There we go. Go and create port 80 on there and set that up as a web server. So now I've got, and I've got a machine set up in there. Sorry, having some technical troubles in there. So one of the things you can do is you can go and you can attach these virtual machines into a virtual network. This is a really cool feature, especially if you're building hybrid applications. Virtual network supports site-to-point, or excuse me, point-to-site connectivity in there. So if I want, I can, I'm really having some troubles here. Okay, let's go back to slides. So infrastructure as a service, sorry about the demo there. So infrastructure as a service, so being able to provide you flexibility to run Windows Server or Linux servers, run the workloads you want to work on there, and then support for virtual private networking. So if you want to create a virtual private network to connect your data center to VMs you've created in your data or the VMs you create in Azure, you can do that. The VMs you create in Windows Azure will look like they're part of your data center within there. You can also create point-to-site virtual networking within there. So if you want to create a VPN connection or create a network of servers that aren't exposed on the public internet, you can connect to those using a VPN, and you'll actually get a session on that a little later today where we'll go into some more depth on that. Windows Azure is really designed and optimized around a number of different workloads. infrastructure services like I talked about. A really important one is also dev and test. If you have a team of developers and they want to build a new application or run testing on that, Windows Azure is the perfect environment to be able to go and set that up. You can go and provision one or more virtual machines in there, deploy your applications within it, do your development, do your testing within there, provision those machines, run those tests. Once you're done, you can deprovision the machines, so you're not paying for those machines as if you were running them all the time. Other workloads like web available within there. So we have Azure Websites provides higher level application services as a PaaS to run web services and applications. Mobile services. So if you need data services and also user management services, we provide higher level services to run all the back end plumbing for your mobile sites. SQL, we provide both as a service or just in the ability to be able to go and create and provision SQL Server virtual machines within there. Other services like big data. So if you have lots of data you want to crunch or you're using Hadoop today, you can go and provision VMs to go run Hadoop yourself, or you can use our Hadoop as a service within there. And then other things like integration. I think this is really an important topic, actually. I mean, we've all got existing applications, legacy applications that we're running today. Windows Azure provides a lot of high-level services like BizTalk services, Service Bus, and others to help build hybrid applications so you can extend the applications you're running and managing today and then extend them and add new value and new features to them within Windows Azure. And then other services like media. So for companies that are producing, ingesting, encoding, and delivering video, we have a higher level PaaS for media services within there to provide all of that functionality. It's all scalable. So as I mentioned, one of the higher level services is our mobile services. And this really allows you to easily build backends for any of your mobile applications you want to build. This provides services like data, identity, push notifications, and then also background job processing as well. And you know, Windows Azure, you know, we want to be open in this. So of course we support Windows 8, Windows Phone 8, but we also have SDKs and support for iOS, Android, and then also just straight HTML5 as well. Here's a little graphic in here. You've got a phone application here, and that goes and talks to the mobile services there for things like data and then identity services in there. And then also supports custom scripts that you can write to build even richer value into your applications. The other service I want to talk about, and I'll go into some detail here, is Azure Websites. Azure Websites just went to general availability this past June. We have a free tier, there's a shared tier, which is still in preview, and then our standard tier available now. Azure Websites, just like the rest of Azure, is built to be very flexible and also very open. We have great support for ASP.NET, of course, but also support Node.js, PHP, or Python right out of the box. It's flexible in terms of deployment. You can use the web deploy to push a site or publish a site into Azure Websites, or you can deploy through FTP or Git, or you can use TFS as well. Websites is really economical. I mean, you can start for free. If you sign up for Azure, we'll give you 10 websites for free, and then a 20 meg SQL database or a 20 meg MySQL database. And then you can scale it up as your traffic grows. Also available now, Azure Websites has the ability to do auto-scaling as well, and I'll show you a little bit of that. All right, so let's jump into a demo. These demos are totally going to work, I promise. Okay. Oh, there it is. Yay! See, that didn't take too long. I just had to go back to slides for a little. Thanks, thanks for the golf clap. I appreciate that. Yes, disconnect. Okay, so if I want to go, I'm going to go and create a new website in here. All We'll just call this web demo one, select my subscription. I can select my region within here. Azure Websites is available within these five regions here. So this Eastern US, Northern Europe, East Asia, West US, or the North Central US. I'll just pick Eastern US. No database. And let's see, I'll pick a GitHub. So I'm gonna publish this from source control. So there's a number of options here I can select. I can select Team Foundation Service. So if I want, I can go in here. And then select in the URL to my Team Foundation Services account. And then this will list some repositories within here. I'm not going to create it from this. I'll go ahead and pick GitHub. Oh, some others in here. So I could pick a local Git repository as well, GitHub. You can publish from Dropbox if you want, although I'm not quite sure who does that. Bitbucket is another one, and CodePlex, and you can also select an external repository, and that supports both Git and Mercurial repositories within there. So I'll just go ahead and select GitHub. This will go ahead and OAuth into GitHub here. So this is hitting my account over on GitHub right now. So I will go and pick this little guy right here. And that'll go and start provisioning that site. So it's going to provision the website. It's going to contact GitHub, and it's going to do a pull on the website there, or a push. And so here, I'll go ahead and just click on that. So let's go and just, I'll show you. This is a very simple little website. Just type in my name. Mark says, hello, hello. So let me give you a little tour in here. So I've got the dashboard within here. So I can get some stats in here, like number of requests, data in, data out, server errors. This tab here show me the number of deployments. So as I go and I make updates to the project, say locally, and then do a commit into GitHub, Azure Websites will automatically pick that up. So it's using hooks back into GitHub. And when it sees a commit in there, it'll go ahead and push it. So anytime you push changes for your website, they're going to automatically get deployed out live. If I make a mistake, I'll show you that one later. You can actually roll that back. There's a monitor tab in here, so if I want, I can go ahead and add more metrics. And then in this configure tab here, I can make some other changes as well. I can select the version of the .NET framework or PHP if I'm using it, which I'm not. Oh, actually, I am. Let's set that back. I can also set SSL certificates within here. So if I go and I upgrade this to using the standard tier, I can now go ahead and deploy SSL certificates. We support two different types of certificates in there. The SNI certificates, which is the server name indication certificates, which is basically a cert by a name. We also support IP-based certificates as well, which is basically a cert by IP address. We also have support for custom domains within there. So you can go ahead and you can use, obviously, your Azure Websites.net, but most people want to use their own custom domains for their sites. So you can go ahead and create and do your custom domain right within here. You can also make some other changes in here. You can turn on application logging and then also, file system logging and then storage logging within here as well. So let's do something. I'm going to scale this guy up. So don't DDoS my site just yet, okay? I'm only running on one instance. If I want to go ahead and scale this up, I can move this to shared. And now I can scale this thing up to 2 instances, all the way up to 6 instances. So now I have 6 processes handling requests from my website that's coming in. And say that's not enough. Whoops. Let's say I want to go ahead and upgrade to my own virtual machine. So I'll go ahead and select standard. This is my new tier. And I'll select medium. So now what it's doing, it's provisioning a new medium-sized VM, and it's going to deploy my application within it, right? And I haven't had to touch any code, right? So if you were going to do this in your own data center, what would you have to do? All right, you'd have to go and you'd have to, well, first you got to ask the IT guy to go provision you a machine, right? And then he's got to go set it up. And then a week later, after you've faxed him about 5 or 6 times to go do that, he finally gets to it. And then you get the credentials of the machine, then you deploy your application. Here, I didn't talk to anybody. I just went and did it. Oh, it looks like it failed. All right, so the IT guy is now laughing at me. I'm having lots of fun with demos today. That's right, I can fail on my own, right? Fax myself, tell myself how much I'm not gonna say it. This is a G-rated audience, I'm not gonna. Okay, now I'm running in standard mode on a medium 2-core VM. And now if I wanna scale this out, let's say I wanna run this thing on that one VM, I want to run it on 2. Awesome, we'll scale that out. All right, so where was I? Oh yeah, back to the IT guy, right? So I'm just doing this all by myself, right? I don't have to ask anybody, I don't have to do anything. And Windows Azure is managing all the reprovisioning and the deployment for this. I don't have to touch the code, I don't have to do anything. It's just happening for me. Is this done? Okay, so now I'm running on 2 instances. That's so fast, I didn't even realize it. So now I want to show you something that's really cool. So we just this last June released AutoScale. AutoScale is really cool. I think when most people think about AutoScale, they think that's something I really need if I get slash dotted or my campaign takes off or I just get a whole ton of customers. I get all Instagrammed, you know, right? And I get 10 million customers in a single month. That's pretty cool. But really what I think AutoScale, now you can DDoS the site, I don't care. Right, because now I'm gonna be running from anywhere between 1 and 4 instances. Right, and that didn't take any time because it didn't redeploy or do anything. Right, it just set it up. So now, if my site, or the VM for that site, gets somewhere between 60-80%, Azure websites will go and now start provisioning additional VMs, right? And it'll manage that, it'll actually redeploy the application, load balance the application. Within there. The real key with AutoScale is not just that it reacts to when you have peaks in demand. It's the way it reacts when those peaks go away, right? Because obviously you're only going to pay for what you use, and that works the other way too. So if, say the peaks go away or the traffic goes away, we'll deprovision those websites, right? And it'll check it about every 10 or 15 minutes. And then if it doesn't see the type of traffic in there, it'll say, oh, I don't need 4 sites. CPUs drop below 60%. We'll drop one off, right? And then load balance it over 3 sites. And if it goes down, then load balance it to 2 and then down to 1. I think this is the key value, the key benefit that I don't know if people understand right away with AutoScale, is it's great to give a great experience for your customers, but it's also a really great economic benefit. And there's no reason really to not use something like that. Okay. All right, so the next thing I want to show is I have another site in here. It's basically the same thing. It's just a little ASP web page in here. One of the things I love about Azure is its flexibility. How many people love the command line? You guys, you're all developers, right? So you all love the command line, right? I love the command line. This is where I get, this is where people get work done, I think, is in the command line. Windows Azure provides an awesome command line interface to be able to manage or provision or do darn near anything within Azure, right? So you can go and you can download and install our CLI tools and then set this up to be able to manage anything in here. So let's just say I want to get a list of the VMs I've got running in here. So now this will go. And this is basically doing what the web interface is, right? It's talking to, it's, or to our portal. It's talking to the REST interfaces around Azure and then going and getting all that data. So here's my VMs. So I had my one MJB demo one, the one I couldn't quite get into. And then my MJB VM demo one, that's the one I just created. And then a couple more in there. I can list websites. Whoops. There's all the sites I've got in there. So one of the things I love doing is creating sites. So I've got a little script here, and I'm going to create a new site. So syntax here is Azure site create. The name of the site is Say Hello ASP. And then I've got some switches in here. So this first one is GitHub, which is going to say go deploy it from source control from GitHub. And then I want to pass in my username. I didn't put my password in here because you could put your password in here, but this is a demo, so I'm not going to do that. But if you wanted to, say, automate something like this, right, or run this as part of a larger batch job or a script job, you could put your password in here too. And then I'll say what GitHub repository I want to go and grab. And then I'll set the location within here as well. So I'll just go and cut and paste. I don't see anybody in here that's just like looking up and then like hammering like this, so. All right, so now it's gonna go create the new site. Now it's gonna go check GitHub, so it's asking me for my credentials. So I'll type in my password. It's going, now it's going retrieving all the repositories against my GitHub account. Starting the work there. Boom, okay, so let's go and check. Yeah, and there is, there's my new site right there. So let's just say I don't really like that, so I don't like the web portal, so what is one of my favorite? I like launching the browser from the command line. There's just something really awkward about that, right? Hold on, let me go launch a browser from a command line. So there, and there's my site, right? So it's just simple. Just type in my name. Hey, everybody. All right. So that's just this little site right here. Now let's go back. I'll go ahead and click in here. And there's my active deployment right there. So one of the things I wanted to show you was rollback. So let's go in here. I'm going to open this up, and I know everybody edits their web files inside GitHub's little editor here. Let's see. So I'm going to change this. Let's just say you hire Mark to go do some web development, and you come to realize that I'm not that good at it. So I start doing stuff like this. And I'm going to commit that. Well, of course, since we've got GitHub hooked up to it, it's of course going to go ahead and deploy that right away, right? So I've updated that. So I'm going to go and browse it. And I come in the morning and I say, hey, Mark, how's it going? I'm like, yeah, whatever. And then you go and you hit the website and you see this in there and you're like, oh God, I'm gonna fire that guy. And you realize, you know what, I don't have to. I can go ahead and just redeploy the original. That's it. And I say, Mark, you're fired. That's it. Get out. Pack your stuff. Then you go back and you redeploy it. So that's one of the features I love about Azure websites in there is even if you make a mistake, right? Because nobody breaks the build, right? You guys have never broken a build ever, right? Or done something like that. Well, maybe you've, I'm sure you've never done something like that, but broken the build. With Azure websites, because you've got source control right within here with the Git repository on the server, you could go ahead and just roll that back every time. And that works if you're using TFS as well within there. It doesn't matter. So another thing I want to show you, because I know really this is where you live all day, right? In Visual Studio. So one of the things I love in here is with the .NET, Azure .NET SDK 2.1, I believe, we added some new cool little features in here within Visual Studio. So now you can go ahead and you get this little Windows Azure thing in here, and you can go and look at cloud services or storage. Refresh. And here you can see I've got storage in here. Here's my VMs within here. And then the thing I really like is also my websites. So if I want, I can go ahead and right-click that and view the settings in there. And then I can go ahead and get some kind of management control over this over the sites in here. I can open it up within the management portal. I could stop and restart the site. Other little things like changing the .NET framework. I can turn logging all on and off. That sort of thing in there. So, or I can open it up, just click it here, and it'll take me right to it in the portal. So I think this is a cool little feature because really this is kind of, I think, where people live all day. Who lives in Visual Studio all day? Yeah, that's more like it. Are you sure? Command line's pretty cool. No? Okay. You're missing out. So the thing I want to kind of reemphasize here is, you know, the focus, especially with something like Azure Websites, is just to think about your apps, right? You notice when I was doing all that stuff within Azure Websites there, I wasn't thinking about infrastructure, right? I was making fun of it in some ways, right? Because you don't have to fax your IT guy to go and get some servers provisioned for you and get certificates loaded and credentials and all that stuff. I was just focused on the source code, right? Didn't have to focus on anything else with scaling or rolling it back or anything else. That's really a key, especially for the higher level PaaS services in there, is to not have to worry about that stuff, right? We're developers. We don't want to have to think about that stuff. It should be taken care of for us. And with Windows Azure, we provide a ton of application building blocks. These are application services that you can use in your applications to go build these rich, full cloud applications within there. Things like storage. We have great storage support for blob storage, SQL tables, traffic manager, which is great for load balancing or failover, identity services within there, caching. We just released a new cache service. Does anybody know about our caching service? Yeah, so we just released a brand new caching service about, I think, 3 weeks ago. Prior to that, we just had a shared cache service. We now have a new unified Windows Azure cache. So who's used the SDK cache in the past? Most of you. So now basically what we've got is a new cache that's a managed version of the SDK cache that's available within there. And we've got new sizes too. You can start as small as 128 meg and then go as large as 150 gig. And if that's not enough, you can just, you know, write us a note or call us and we'll give you even more within there. And those are all dedicated. You can get 10 name caches within the standard tier and the premium tier. Custom expiries on everything in there. It's lots of features, lots of cool stuff. Definitely go check it out right now. The new Windows Azure cache is 50% off during the preview period. So go take a look. Messaging services within there, I'll talk a little bit about that. And then integration if you're doing hybrid. So we'll hear more about hybrid stuff later this week. Is it today or is it tomorrow? It's tomorrow's session, okay. So Sam will give a great talk about the hybrid. I think this is really the thing to pay the most attention to, right? Because as I said, you know, everybody's got legacy, right? 80% of what we do is maintaining applications we've already built, right? And maybe 20% on doing something new. The integration story and the hybrid story is really about you guys, right? About taking those applications and giving them new life and then adding new features to that and doing that in a really cost-effective way, right? In a time-effective way. So another service I want to talk about is SQL database. Who does database stuff? Everybody? Right. Who's used SQL database? Right, so SQL database is essentially a PaaS for SQL Server, right? This is our relational SQL Server engine in the cloud. It's clustered for high availability, and like I said, it's fully managed, right? And also there's support for SQL reporting in there as well. So I'll do a little demo here and just create a little SQL database. All right, so I'll just give it a little name. And then I've got a server already created here. And I'll go and I'll provision that. I've already got one right here, so I can go ahead. If I want, I can click manage on that. And yes. And then it's just going to fire up this little Silverlight control. This is a very lightweight way to go and manage your SQL, Azure SQL databases within here. You can also, there's an air connecting the server. This is awesome, firewalls. See, that's the Microsoft network. That's what's doing that to me. Okay. I am not going to show you that. We're back to slides. Awesome. Slides never fail, by the way. Did you notice? They always compile. There's never a build error with a slide. Just thought I'd say that. Oh, how'd I go back here? Yes, the demo. Service bus. So I wanted to spend a few minutes talking about that. How many of you have used Service Bus? Awesome. This is a service and a piece of functionality within Azure that I don't think enough people understand or fully appreciate. This is really the core at building hybrid applications that you're going to use in your business. It's also for those who really want to build truly scalable cloud applications, a real key piece of technology that you should use or should understand and use within there. Functionally, service bus is our messaging and relay service within Windows Azure. I love this example. So I know Magnus is a huge cat lover. And I know that Magnus spends a lot of time on YouTube looking at cat videos. And that
every day.
Yeah. Yeah, and that also you're out there with your handy cam taking videos of cats, aren't you, out in the parks?
Yes.
That's right, and then uploads them. So Magnus came to me one day, he goes, I really want to build a kitty YouTube, right, so that I can have a website and I can upload my videos and that all of my friends that love cats can go build or can go and upload their pictures of cats. And so this is a picture of
really?
Magnus's.
You just thought of that now?
It's a very cute cat. I'm making this up totally as I go along.
Wow. So,
we sat down, we talked, and you know, this site has to do a few things. One, it has to serve the videos that Magnus and everybody uploads within there, right? So it's got to work as a web server. it also needs to be able to ingest new videos. So if people upload videos within there, it needs to be able to accept them and then store them. Third, it needs to encode them. So I want to be able to serve these out in multiple video formats. I may be on a phone or my iPad or a Windows machine or whatever. I need to be able to encode these things so people can go and watch them on the player. And then the fourth thing I need to do is I need to cache all the content within there. So the first stab at this thing, we go and set up a load balancer, some web servers, and we write an application that does all these things together, right? And then, of course, a little cache on the side there. It works fine when you got light load and it's not doing too much. But, you know, Magnus knows a lot of people and a lot of cat people especially, right? So what you end up with is an architecture that looks like this over time, and it just basically becomes unmanageable. This is a tightly coupled application, right? All of the code to serve the video, ingest the new files, encode it and cache it is all sitting in a single application. This doesn't scale. And it doesn't really work by just throwing more hardware at it. It's not very efficient. The way you do this in designing for the cloud is you follow these three things. You basically make things loosely coupled. So the thing that serves the video is different from the thing that ingests the video and the thing that encodes the video and the thing that then caches the video. It needs to be service enabled, right? We need to create APIs and services around that thing so that there's an API for everything to talk to everything else. And then third is use messaging and queues within there. So now what you end up with is an architecture that looks like this. So we've got the cat video that's going in with the load balancer, some web servers, and then you're using queues. So as files go up or as people go ahead and click submit for the file, they go to a queue there. And then you have a list of ingest servers that scale up or down depending on how many videos are being uploaded. Same thing with the encoding servers. They scale up and down depending on how many items are in the queue there. And then everything goes into the cache. This is something that scales and it's very manageable that way, right? And they scale independently, right? You may have a day where a lot of people are watching cat videos, but nobody's really uploading anything. So I would scale more web servers in that case, right? Or it may be a day where it's a nice sunny day and everybody's out taking pictures of their kitties and uploading them up onto Magnus's kitty YouTube. Are you liking my story? Okay. And uploading them, it's a true story, that's right. Uploading them to Magnus's kitty YouTube site. So anyway, I just wanted that. So with Service Bus, that provides kind of the technology to be able to provide that thing, the queuing, the messaging, being able to write the decoupled applications, allowing those independent pieces to scale independently. Much more manageable, much more scalable, much more cost efficient too, because you're not throwing just hardware over and over at the thing. It scales only where it needs to. So the other thing I want to talk about is Windows Azure Store. So do we have a session on store?
We do.
You're doing a session on store? Okay. That's the end of day tomorrow?
Yep.
Okay. So one of the things I really love about Azure is the Windows Azure Store. So this really provides kind of a marketplace for ISV partners. That's my bag right there. Hey, you can sit there if you want. That's my stuff right there. So that's okay. Sorry. I'm reacting real time. But provides a marketplace for people to go and try new services. And the nice thing about it is that it's integrated within your build there. Just to list of some of the partners we have in there. So we've got things like, you know, Bing Search, but there's data partners within there. There's Microsoft Translator, Phone Number Validator. Some of the app services that are in there I think are really awesome. New Relic is fantastic. Who's used New Relic before? Yeah, have you seen the new SDK, the .NET version we've got for Azure website. So they've got a new version of New Relic that just came out this past June, right around build. That's the new .NET version, and it actually works with Azure website. So if you've got a .NET site that's hosted on Azure websites, you can install New Relic and get all of the performance data within there. New Relic's fantastic. If you have a site and you can't figure out what's wrong with it, run New Relic on it. It'll tell you what's going on. ClearDB is our provider for MySQL databases, also within Azure websites, but also across Azure as well. AppDynamics provides performance management and monitoring within your application. SendGrid for email service within there. If you know you can't, I don't think you can run your own email server. You can now?
You can, but
Oh, really? I thought it was because you couldn't do the IP verification, that you couldn't run your own email server on there.
You need to pass through sometimes.
Yeah.
Some of the IPs are blacklisted on those services, like on the 365.
Yeah. Well, if you don't want to run your own email server, you can use SendGrid. MongoLab provides MongoDB as a service. These guys are fantastic, and they're actually one of the most popular services. Who's used MongoDB? Just a few of you? Yeah, so MongoDB, you know, document database, and they provide it as a service. So you can go into the store and go and provision a new MongoDB, and you don't have to do anything. They just give you a connection string. Just, you know, use the, there's a .NET API or .NET SDK for it, and they've got SDKs for everything. Anyway, Azure Store is great, and Bjorn, you're going to give a talk on it in a day tomorrow, so fantastic. So some things I want to talk about, this is some stuff we've announced just this past summer. So beginning in June, no longer are we charging for stopped virtual machines within Windows Azure. This was a feature request we heard loud and clear from everybody over and over again. So we've changed that now, so we won't charge you for stopped VMs. We also do per-minute billing. So if you go prior to this, if you had gone and fired up a VM and ran it for a minute, we would charge you a full hour for it. Now if you go and you start a VM and you run it for a minute, we charge you for a minute. We also made some changes to our MSDN licenses. Who all uses MSDN or has an MSDN subscription in here? Okay, out of those people, how many have activated Azure? Okay, so there's a few of you in here that haven't done it yet. So we have some new MSDN use rights within here now. So now you can go ahead and use SharePoint and Windows Server, SQL, BizTalk, and have full dev test available within Windows Azure. We have new rates for MSDN dev tests in here. So Windows Server, standard at 9 cents an hour. The MSDN price at 6 cents an hour. The biggest savings, you're going to look at SQL Enterprise at $2.19 an hour, 6 cents an hour, and BizTalk Enterprise at $2.11 an hour, and that's 6 cents an hour. So some big savings for using MSDN versus versus the standard rates for these services within there. So with the changes with the use rights, we also made some changes to how you get benefits through MSDN. So now you get a monthly credit. So if you're at a professional subscription level, you get $50 a month in Azure. At a premium, you're getting $100 a month in Azure, and for Ultimate, it's $150 a month in Azure. So let's say if you're at the premium level, you could run three, I think it's large VMs, 16 hours a day, just to give you some kind of equivalent of how much you're talking about, or 80 small VMs, you could all be running a load test for 20 hours. Or 50 HD Insight nodes for 10 hours. So if you're doing some big data jobs or processing like that, that would pay for it. Or 100 websites on a standard VM, on a standard Azure, on a standard tier in Azure websites, plus a database within there. Cost MSDN would pay for it. Your subscription would pay for it. What's that slide doing in there? Wait, that's what I want to show. And with the changes here, now you can go to your subscription page and then see what your usage is within there. This is another ask we always got. How much have I got left, right? Well, now you've got to know because it's a monetary credit within there. So you can go and see what you've got left. And then, of course, if you want, you can say, oh, I want to remove my spending limit and just go nuts within there. No, I'm just kidding. You don't have to. And then the last thing I want to mention, and some other guys will talk about it too in their talks. So who has, I want to know, who has MSDN and has not activated their Azure benefits? There's like one guy, two. Okay. We have a new promotion on now. So if you're an MSDN subscriber and you've not activated your Azure benefit, go in and activate it. And then you actually have to deploy something too, by the way. I don't know if anybody's mentioned this. You have to deploy something within there. And then we'll enter you to win an Aston Martin V8 Vantage. We'll actually pay the tax on this thing. We'll deliver it to you. We will not pay for the insurance. You've got to pay for the insurance. Sorry. So you will probably have to take a second job. And we've got about, there's about 10 days left in the promotion for this. So you two guys get on it right now. So You can go. Normally there's a URL in here, but I'm not. There's a little competition we've got going on, so I'm not gonna.
They're asking if you're gonna pay the gas for it.
No, not European gas prices. Maybe if I was in Texas or something, it's like 30 cents a gallon, I could maybe cover it. Okay, so just wrapping up. So anyway, that's it for my talk. You know, get in there, try it out, start now. I think most of you are in there and using Azure today. If you've got any questions, I'll take a few questions, and thank you.